The next item on our agenda is correspondence. Our secretary, Michael Ewing, is not with us tonight. Are we aware of any correspondence for the record? No. Okay, public comment. Anyone signed in for public comment? Okay, moving right along. Can I have a motion for approval of meeting minutes? Can I have a second? And these are the minutes for the November 19th regular meeting. Debbie?
We need to delete the ACES report.
There was no report.
No report.
Okay.
I just need to know who was second twice on that motion. I have Sue Kelly as first.
Tom.
Tom, over there on the other side of the.
Behind me, yeah, computer.
Okay. Any other changes or questions about the meeting? Okay, as amended then, we will vote. All those in favor of approval? Anyone voting against or abstaining? No, it's unanimous. Thank you very much. And we'll go right into the superintendent's report. Dr. Stella?
Thank you. Well, good evening, everyone. I'll start with a quick Beecher Road update, and certainly the focus has been on the weather the past few days. We've had two delayed openings and a closing, and for the benefit of our new school board members and anyone else in the audience who doesn't know, I have to brag a little bit. I'm up in the morning at 4:30, as well as my fellow superintendents, and we go to all the reports, the satellite reports, and we make our calls too. And in Woodbridge, I call the highway department. I call the police department to have one of the officers in the cruiser give me a report as far as the side roads, speak to the bus company, and the four superintendents from BOA are in constant communication. Then we make our decision, and then I wake up my administrative staff. I start with Marcia. When she hears that phone ring, she says, oh no, here we go. And Marcia contacts at least 10 different radio stations, TV, goes on computer, everything, and then there's a whole telephone network that goes into effect for the staff members that want to be on that network. When we make our judgment, we make one for the region, for the BOA region. So you may have a situation where there might be one street that seems so clear, but you have another area where it's really dangerous for the children to be picked up by bus or to leave, or for staff members to drive. So we take these decisions very seriously. They're not arbitrary by any means. And I'm just hoping for better weather in the future. Also, I had the pleasure, I'm sure the PTO will mention this too, of attending, in fact, Mr. Lipsay was with us, a wonderful dedication. We have an owl out front, the wise owl, a statue that was a gift from the class of 2005. And from my understanding, we had a local mason who donated the work that went into, the artwork that went into it. And it was a wonderful symbol of how a group of children, even though they graduated or left in 2005, still remember their alma mater. They remember, in the way, it's a way of symbolizing the value that they placed in the dedicated staff, administrators, and teachers, and the education that they got here. It's also a reminder to us that our children just don't leave us. They're part of us. And they represent Beecher Road School no matter where they go. So it was a beautiful, beautiful ceremony. Holly Pine and Carrie Webster, again, examples of the type of leadership that we have in the PTO, people who just step forward and get things done for the, to help children. Now, what I'll do is, looking forward to giving my initial budget report to the entire board, and I'd like to go up to the podium so I'm facing you.
Well,
this budget was thoughtfully put together with the premise, with the mantra that we want to move ahead and have higher quality education for our children, at the same time being respectful to the taxpayer. And the challenges that we face in putting any kind of budget together, is educational budget, is that we want to attain become a higher performing district without an unreasonable burden on the taxpayer. In this budget, in a way, we're trying to keep the status quo, not of quality, but of expenditure, but looking for higher quality at the same time. We want to improve student achievement commensurate with high expectations and continue to create a shared vision that will help to develop a 21st century model of education that I so frequently speak about. And we spoke in concrete terms about what does a 21st century model mean. It means children highly literate, going beyond the traditional reading skills, reading and writing of king and queen in elementary schools, but going beyond that to the digital skills that they'll need, becoming independent readers, writers, lifelong learners, using technology as a medium for learning, well-prepared in the core academic areas such as science and math, and also developing strategies of wellness, whether that be in nutritional factors or physical fitness. We want them to not only study foreign cultures, but interact with foreign cultures. And language development is so important. We want to take a look at that. We believe that we have a clear roadmap for 2008-2009 and for the future. The board has come up with defined goals, and the district, with the help of staff, administration, working together, and in a process facilitated by the executive director of the consortium, we've come up with goals that align with the school board goals, and that's the tri-state consortium that I'm talking about. Now, what does the budget support? Let me give you a holistic presentation on this here. It supports implementation of the board goals, implementation of the strategic plan, supports our professional learning initiatives, and I'll go into detail with that, and it supports some new curriculum initiatives. Now, there are factors that contributed to the budget development. For example, all provisions of the collective bargaining agreements in place now have been met. And the budget provides for mandated special education costs, those that have been, that we know are encumbered now or have been designated. And it works on the intern model versus the substitute model of teachers. That not only provides continuity and improved quality of instruction, but in the past has resulted in cost savings. And it addresses the business office audit as we seek to develop new, better ways of developing strategies for even more effective fiscal practices. Some of the budget realities that we faced in putting this budget together were as follows. Salaries and benefits alone account for 78% of the total budget, 78%. Salaries and benefits comprise 97.66% of the budget increase, nearly 100% of the budget increase. Health medical costs, as everywhere across the country, continue to be a problem and a challenge. And the rising cost of electricity, heating oil, and fuel oil present fiscal challenges in spite of the fact that we are looking for energy-saving ways of operating. Other budget realities. There will be cost savings from our five-year enrollment plan and projected enrollment plan, at least as we project the numbers today. There is no contingency for unanticipated special education cost. So any unanticipated cost, the town has asked us to go straight to the boards of selectmen and finance with that information. And Chuck will explain this in a little more detail later. There's a GASB requirement. This has to do with funding for future retiree health benefits. Corporations have been doing it for years. It's caught up to the municipalities and the school districts now. And there's a mandate to give an accounting of what funding will be needed for the future. But as a school district working in partnership with the town, we're working for the whole town, and that means the citizens. So what we decided to do is put in $151,376 as a way of contributing towards future expenses that we don't want the taxpayers down the line to have to face as a surprise. We believe this is a frugal and prudent kind of thing to do. The budget process, to the extent that we could, we used a zero-based approach. Everything had to be defended as far as alignment with goals and initiatives. There was input from the school, from staff, from administrators. It went from teacher learning teams with administrators looking over, coming to us, sitting down and having to defend their request. There was a wish list. There was a list of things we'd really like to have, and there was the things of what are the top priorities that will get us and help us to enable us to perform our mission. There was board oversight, and there is board oversight in every step of the way. As an example, last Monday night, we had a long session with the school board finance committee and review the budget together with them. We will be presenting to the board today, and there's another day set aside in January. We will be presenting to town officials at the end of January, beginning of February. And of course, there'll be a budget hearing in April. Let me be more specific about how the budget supports mission. It continues to support our class size guidelines. The guidelines were established by a task force appointed by the school board in 1997, and their recommendations were approved by the school board. And we were about 95% with this budget, we will be 95% in compliance with the recommendations of these guidelines. The only exception would be the sixth grade class, which might have 1 to 2 additional children as compared to what the recommendations of the task force was. But in that case, we put a little asterisk, we are watching it carefully, and we feel, in consulting with the sixth grade teachers and the administration, that it's not something that's hitting us by surprise. That's something that we could address as far as the needs of the children with the existing support staff, and that we can handle it. But it'll be something under review. There'll be a focused professional development on specific initiatives that impact on student learning. There'll be some new initiatives that I'll explain, required instructional materials, and continued updating and alignment of the core curriculum. Now, the new initiatives. We're overdue for an upgraded social studies curriculum. The current one is over 10 years old. It needs an update. We'll be working in a collaborative process with the BOA districts in this endeavor, so it's a wonderful opportunity really to come forward with it. And of course, the social studies curriculum is going to be in line with information literacy strategies, the use of technology as a medium for learning, research-based learning as far as helping the children to develop that, and also the digital reading strategies that they'll need in doing that. And I'm going to ask members of my administrative team to make some comments as I go along, too. Mary Lutori will be my point person in this endeavor as far as working with a team of teachers and with BOA teams during the summer. Mary Lou, do you want to add anything to what I'm saying about this here?
Sure, I can.
You want to speak into the microphone?
If you want me to. See, now I forgot what I was going to say. Okay. What we've been doing is, since September, meeting with the BOA district, and it actually is an offshoot of administrator meetings that have been going on now for about the past year and a half. And what we're doing is talking about social studies at Bethany, Orange, and the Amity Middle School. What we're finding is that the students who are coming to the middle school and then going to the high school, they're either oversaturated in certain areas or they are not up to speed in certain content areas. So our hope is to work together and have a cohesive social studies curriculum, one that gives students assured learning experiences in Woodbridge for sure, but as they move forward. And we have actually are very excited about this. This is an opportunity. This is a working committee. Both Nancy White and Dan Chase will be working with me from Woodbridge, and we'll be getting going on that in January.
Thank you very much. Another initiative is that this budget will support planning and implementation of a cohesive K-6 world language program, and I emphasize that K-6. It's language acquisition. We're all aware of its sensitivity to other cultures are so important in the 21st century model. And the timing is right for a world language audit that aligns our program with what's happening in the other BOA districts and with the middle school and with the high school, and that identifies a research-based model that will involve children in mastery learning. So I think it's a good point, and this budget supports it. Administrators, any comments on that?
Well, just that we feel that we have been talking for about a year and a half about looking at our world language program. Really, our program has been one that leans more towards exposure than actual sequential teaching of a language. And so we're talking about raising that bar and in terms of the kind of curriculum we want to deliver and also delivering it K-6.
And another initiative is that we want to introduce Reader's Workshop in a systemic way. There are some classes that have been involved with it. Let me give some background. We're progressing very nicely with our Writer's Workshop. As you know, Writer's Workshop is a child-centered way of operating with it. The child is the focus, and it's an interactive process. And I'm so pleased to say that Writer's Workshop is being used in 75 to 80% of our classrooms. And the expectation is by September 09, it will be in 100% of the classrooms. It's a way of helping children not only to develop the skills of a writer, but to develop skills of thinking and to bring reading and writing together for new levels of learning. Reader's Workshop is a natural extension. It provides for interactive student-centered learning. And the emphasis is on developing among students strategies of a good reader, but at the same time fostering the love of reading in multiple genres and the development of independent reading skills. And I would ask any of my administrators to comment on that.
Well, I'll come up to the microphone for this. it's really true that Writer's Workshop has really been transformational in our school, not only for the kind of writing that we're seeing our children do, but in the ways that teachers are teaching. And Reader's Workshop really is the very next step. And, you know, 2.5 years into our Writer's Workshop, teachers are now saying to us who have sort of led this and are at the top tier, when can we do Reader's Workshop? When can we get professional development in for that? And I think what's so exciting, it is very linked and it is very integrated. But the kinds of components of ways of teaching and the best practice that comes out of Columbia, we're seeing it in all content areas. You know, the kind of really, the method of hitting every component of a mini lesson and how you exchange back and forth between the teacher directing till the child is then directing. We're seeing it in other areas. We're seeing it in mathematics, we're seeing it in social studies, we're seeing it in science, because the method of teaching is so wonderful. So number one, it's so exciting when teachers say, can we do this? Because we really want to go in this direction. And number two, the way that we've done professional development has been really the best way to do it, which is we have on-site consultants working in classrooms all year with teachers. And I think that's part of its success.
We're trying to create more goals for that on the professional learning. With professional development, we have a focus, and our focus is on really the type of powerful, ongoing professional learning that's going to impact on student learning. And there are a few key areas that we're focused on. An overarching area is the development of professional learning teams. Now, we've started recently. It's just August that we've got started, so we have a few months under our belt. It's a process, but it's a work in progress. And the idea is to put teams of teachers together on every grade level. Give them the opportunity, just as in the corporate world when you bring teams together, where teachers can share their individual strengths, passions, and so on, to channel their energies and wisdom in a common direction. And while doing so, taking responsibility not only for the children in their class, but performance across the board as far as the entire grade, and all teachers and administrators together taking responsibility for the whole school. And in the learning teams, there's a focus, again, on three questions. What is it that we expect children to learn? How will we know if they learn it? And if they don't, what do we do? I'm expressing these questions in very simple terms, but that's basically what it is. And perhaps, Sheila, would you like to say something? I'll give you a chance to. Another microphone.
I think from the special education point of view, we're always called to use data to track our students' progress in terms of their individual programs. But what's happening now is really bringing the focus of collaboration to a different level, with special educators not just looking at their own data, but looking at it in terms of the general curriculum and the state standards, and how do we really assist our students and all students in having the best access to the general curriculum and making the best progress possible in those standards and expectations. Had a discussion earlier, and I'm the newbie on the team, so I get excited about something and I want to share it. But this summer, I was fortunate enough to train in responsive classroom, in writer's workshop, and in professional learning communities. So I had a very busy summer season, and I think I've said this to you before, and I'll say it again tonight, to see our focus merge. All of the initiatives that we have, they're not separate things here and there. They all are merging together and bringing us the intellectual, the social and emotional development of our children. Writer's Workshop, Responsive Classroom have the same focus in terms of how we're using our teacher talk and our modeling to help students not just learn but interact together. It's really very exciting. Professional learning teams are doing the same thing for all of us. With the benefit for children's development and progress. So,
thank you.
You're welcome.
And I have to give kudos to our staff members, to our teachers, because it's essential that teachers help to translate how we bring this into the classroom and how do we make adjustments and so on. And we're not always in agreement on everything, and in school you never have everyone in full agreement. But what happens is some rich conversations about teaching and learning and what happens with students. And you know, we have some wonderful teacher representatives here tonight. Nancy White is here, and Joe Hollowinkle, for example. Larry Hurwitz, too. And they've been involved, as the other staff members, in powerful professional learning. And they come back with their ideas, and they mix their ideas, and we mix our voices together. But the bottom line is we're looking at the student. That's the center. Other professional development focus is, of course, is on mathematics, science, technology. Those are major things. And Reader's Workshop, we want to take a step forward with that. And you know, perhaps that will involve the initiation of an institute after school ends, again, as we did last year, this time in Reader's Workshop. Or perhaps a teacher's petition, they like it very much, to go down to Columbia for week-long conferences during the summer. So those are possibilities as far as getting started in several of the classrooms. Instructional materials. To give a little detail, we put $17,000 aside for social studies resources. We're not exactly sure how we're going to use it. We know we're going to use it, but we have the end in mind, and we're going to focus probably from the sixth grade down on this here. And we'll bring together the type of resources that are going to help move children together ahead. World language, we put some money aside to work on that program, and Reader's Workshop as well. All the other instructional materials, they're involved with core academic areas, consumables, our special areas, music, art, and so on, technology. And if you have questions later, you can ask on that. I'm When I said status quo budget, I didn't mean as far as the quality of education, because we're moving forward. But we're not adding any new staff. And there's been a current report done by the demographer, Dr. Prouder. He finished a study for us, Woodbridge, was dated in December. And his projection is that we will have no noticeable change in enrollment next year. So we're not asking for any additional staff. And, you know, just a reminder, over the past couple of years, because again, higher quality, respect to the taxpayer, over the past couple of years, we've lost a curriculum coordinator, PPT coordinator, tag teacher, half a secretarial position, and we lost some TAs also in the process. So we have been giving back some positions, and my principals, administrative task, it has not been easy, but we have picked up the duties of the curriculum supervisor. Every district should have a curriculum supervisor with all the mandates from the state and federal, but we're working as a team, and we're trying to absorb that as our commitment to working towards that mantra of higher quality, but at the same time, respect to the taxpayer. There's one change, and Chuck will explain this later, that we're gonna make in future documents. The instructional TAs, it's not 30.6, it's 29.6 that we have on our payroll, and Chuck will explain that. If you look at our next slide here, put together a five-year, I work with the data that Dr. Prouder gave us, and put together a five-year enrollment projection plan that's based on the recommendations of the task force on class size. And with the implementation of this projection, this will result in cost savings for the towns in a very predictable way. And again, I have to caveat, we have to look at the data each year and see what the entry into the system is and the exit levels are too. But as you can see in 07, 08, we have 41. We're gonna maintain, if projections are correct, the same number next year, that would be 41. The following year, we will be able to reduce staff by one classroom teacher. And the following year by another teacher, in the year 2012-13 by an additional teacher. So we are trying to be cost effective. Following slide. Our funding proposal is this here. The 07-08 budget was $11,252,000. We're asking for $11,907,000. 97%+ of that is for contract obligations and benefits. Start adding electricity, fuel, transportation on, inflation, that's nearly 100%. So we're trying to keep a zero-based budget here as far as new things. The increase is 5.82%. But what we've included in the 5.28%, and this is not required by law, we've included $151,376 to pay as a contribution towards the long-term cost of retiree health benefits. If that were excluded from the budget, our budget request would be 4.48%, which in lieu of contract, again, obligations, special education, transportation is a very, very modest request. And I'm going to ask Chuck to come up and go into give you a holistic view of some of the numbers, and then give you a chance for questions and answers and comments.
Okay, this next slide is just a summary of where those increases are, the major cost components of the $655,000 increase that we're requesting. And as Dr. Stell had mentioned, if you look at the first two items, salaries and benefits, that's going to total approximately 97% of that total increase that we're asking for. One area that has gone down substantially is tuition, for our special ed students, and that is just based on the needs that we see projecting on a going forward basis. The next slide shows of the total budget, that's a depiction of what, again, the major cost areas of our total budget and what percentage they make up of that total. And again, if you look at the largest cost components between salaries and benefits, that's making up approximately 78% of that total budget. Other line items such as transportation, that's at 4.57%. Utilities, 2%, heating oil, 1.5%, tuition, 2.8%. So again, as you can see, the major cost components of our budget are salary and benefits. And then we'll just take a quick look at some of the major components within the budget. Salaries. Probably the biggest piece, not probably, is the biggest piece of our budget. That's making up of our 11 million plus budget, 6,900,000 is composed of salaries. And that's with no new additional staff. That's just accounting for the contractual things that we have in place now. Next major area is the benefits. Medical insurance is one of those line items that continues to increase. Right now, I'm projecting in this budget an increase in our premium of 15%. So our medical insurance is $1,877,000. The next line item, the OPEB, GASB 43 and 45, as Dr. Stella had mentioned, we're including in this budget $151,376. Now, there's no requirement that we actually fund that dollar amount, but I think that we're prudent in starting to fund this line item. What the regulations say is that you have to start recognizing the liability for this issue. It doesn't say that you have to actually start funding it at this point. But what I wanted to do is include it in the budget, at least a portion of it, to begin the dialogue. I think there needs to be a lot of dialogue between the Board of Ed and the Town Board of Finance, as well as the Selectmen, to determine exactly how we want to start attacking this problem. So I wanted to put it into the budget to begin to have that dialogue and bring it to the forefront. The other ones are FICA, which is Social Security and Medicare, MRF, which is the Municipal Entire Employees Retirement Fund, life insurance, and then other benefits. So that the total benefit line item is $2,370,000, as you can see. After that, we get into utilities and heating oil. Electricity, water, and sewer, that's right now in the budget at $259,440 and heating oil at $174,785. And I think everybody as homeowners can attest to you know, how the cost of these items are affecting your home budget. So again, we have the budget here that we started in October and November. We're looking at heating oil won't take place for another year, but we'll go out to bid on this probably in February and March. We'll track the market and see where, you know, what we think may be a good entry point to try to lower these costs. But at this point, this is what I have in the budget for those. From an electricity standpoint, again, we entered into an agreement to fix a portion of those costs, and we actually did some retrofit involving the town helped us out as far as from a labor standpoint. So in conjunction with the town, we were able to hopefully, I think, and with some incentives from UI, actually reduce our kilowatt hours. So you know, hopefully we'll be able to, you know, keep reducing that particular line item. But the rate increase is that the, even though we fixed a portion of our electricity bill, there's a part that the generation and that part that we are not able to fix. And so we're looking at an increase on that side. I'm not sure what that will be. So that's what I have in the budget right now for utilities. The next major component is our transportation. And again, we're not looking at adding any new bus runs, nor are we looking at lessening any. These are just basically carrying forward what our current contractual agreements are. And then the no special ed portion of that, of our transportation costs. And then diesel fuel. Next major component is tuition. And that, again, we're not carrying any unanticipated tuition costs in this line item. It's just strictly as we are aware of students within our system now. Again, we're not carrying any unanticipated costs here. And then that's the, and then you also see the tuition for the our winter green agreement that we have in place currently. Next line item is computer software for a total of $49,000. And as you can see on the screen, just a breakout of the various components within that line item. Student information software for $10,000. Homeschool communication. And that's really looking at our website and keeping that up to date. And then we have our SPED IEP software that tracks various components of our students within Special Education Forum, Microsoft licenses, various curriculum software, the mobile computing software, and then other. And then really what this slide is showing you is if you look at our overall total budget, there's not a lot of discretionary costs that we can take a look at. A lot of it is fixed in nature, and this is just trying to highlight that area, showing about 95.7% of our total budget is fixed in some form or nature, and we're really looking at 4% of discretionary spending. And that's the highlight of our budget.
Can you summarize some of the discretionary?
Really, the discretionary is comprised of supplies and then some dues and fees and some of our equipment. And that's really what makes up the bulk of our discretionary spending.
Can you tell us more about the GADSB and what's happening with that? You mentioned that you want to try to bring some dialogue.
Yeah, there's an outside firm was hired, Hook and Holcomb, to do a lot of these statistical and data analysis to take a look at, took a census of our current makeup of employees, and as I said, put a lot of statistics to that and determine what your liability may be in the future. Now, that's at a particular point in time. Snapshot in time. You can do things that will impact that liability on a going forward basis, which would then affect, how much you should fund also. So it's not, once they do that, make that determination of what your liability is, it's not fixed. That's a moving target. So, but it is
this is the first year we're dealing with this?
Yes, it is. And they have that data. I believe that we're trying to set up a either individual meetings with boards or a joint meeting, depending on how everybody's schedule is able to accommodate that. But we're looking at January, bringing in that consultant to actually go through the details as to how they arrive at that number and get into more specifics as to how we want to go about attacking the funding of that.
It's our understanding that the town is going to be doing similar to what you've done, is putting together numbers and making beginning a conversation, the town board, finance board, selectmen, and as well as the board of ed are all going to be tackling this together.
Exactly, it's all being done on a joint basis.
I just wanted you to explain the rationale. I don't really understand why you haven't separated out, you know, in one part the increase is 5.82% and then you exclude it and do a 4.48%. You know, it's confusing. I don't know why we're doing that.
Mainly because it's a new, it's like I said, it's not mandatory that you actually fund this liability at this point, but I think it's prudent that we do. To what extent? I think there could be some dialogue around that issue. So what the attempt was there to show that if we looked at from year to year, we didn't have that funding that we had to look at last year. So I just wanted to show on an apples to apples comparison, if we didn't have that funding mandate, that, you know, that's what our budget would be looking like from a percentage increase standpoint.
And on that, is at some point are we mandated to fund that? I'm just trying to figure out, you know, long term.
Yeah, what it will start to affect the rating, or it may start to affect the rating from a borrowing a fund standpoint. So there's a lot of different issues that, as a town, you need to look at. But at some point, yes. And the more you fund it now, it will reduce your liability on an outgoing basis.
And are you considering that fixed or discretionary in your breakdown of the 95.7 fixed?
That was part of the fixed cost.
And can you give me a sense on the fixed versus discretionary? If we took a look at the percent change in the fixed cost this year versus last time, how much did the fixed cost increase? So if we just looked at that, I'm just trying to get a sense so if we compare apples to apples, if we go back and say, of the budget this year, you know, we have to have a 3.2% increase, whatever it is, or 7.3, just to cover the fixed. I'm trying to get a sense as to that.
Are you saying on a total basis?
Well, if I look at the fixed cost, right, if I compare the fixed cost from last year versus the fixed costs in this budget,
yeah,
presumably that has gone up a certain percentage.
Right.
And is that?
On a weighted basis, because they make up so much of your total cost, it's going to be almost the whole thing.
And I guess what I'm partially trying to figure out is in the zero, you know, sum view of this,
mm-hmm.
have our fixed costs gone up so high that we're now actually taking money out of our, you know, in order to get the our increase to whatever the number is, 4 point something, if we get rid of the gas piece,
mm-hmm.
have we actually decreased the amount we're spending on our discretionary funds to reduce that, or have we just said, you know, we know that a budget has to increase by this percent for the fixed period, so that's a given,
mm-hmm.
and then we're sort of funding discretionary at about the same that we did last year?
Yeah, it hasn't decreased, but it hasn't gone up substantially either. Sure.
But you have a fairly significant positive leverage in that tuition decrease of $130,000.
That's correct.
And if you look at salaries and benefits, which I believe would not include the GASB piece.
No, it does.
Account? Oh, it does.
Yes.
So we'd have to take $150,000 out of that. So instead of being 97% of the increase, it's 95 something of that order. So that but we end up in a position where the truly fixed cost, the fixed cost of faculty and their support rises inexorably at something over 4%. The happy news is that the availability of discretionary funding is facilitated by the unexpected decline in tuition costs for our special ed program.
Probably important to understand that special ed number just happens to be lower this time. It has to do with you know what we can anticipate right now.
Right.
It doesn't count anything that might happen in the unanticipated way. And to compare it year over year, it's not necessarily the following year will be a similar trend. So
right.
You should just put that out there as an underscore.
Yep.
Chuck, can you give us an overview as to how the benefits are handled? Do we put our benefits out to bid? Are we tied to a certain provider for the duration of contracts? How much control do we have over who provides our benefits?
We use a broker, and that broker actually looks at alternatives for us as far as vendor selection as well as plan designs. We've had some talk with implementing. The largest part of your health costs are your claims. So if you can bring those in line, you can that's really what you want to attack as far as trying to lessen that premium cost increase. You can look at wellness programs. You can look at different incentives for your group to take on. There's different things you can bring to the table, and that's really, we use the broker to look at those types of things for us, as well as look at, different carriers and trying to negotiate the best price for us. But what always comes into play is, how well your claims are tracking to what they expected them to be. Yes, David.
I don't know if you're going to like this analysis very much, but I think we have to, be prepared for, some tough questions. And I was just occurring to me that when we're looking at 190,000 decrease in tuition over last year, mm-hmm. and yet we're netting out the GASB at 151, to really look at an honest percent increase, does it make sense that we need to sort of If we're trying to say, well, we're really 4.48%, we're not 5.82%, but we're not sitting there adding back the 190, that might be a windfall for 1 year if you want to look at it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Just like, next year we'll already have built-in GASB, so we're not going to be getting hit with a 151. Maybe it'll be an incremental increase or something like that.
Yeah.
I'm just, thinking that it only took me a little while to figure that out. Somebody else is going to figure it out, and we should be prepared to address, so we're not trying to just see this through rose-colored glass.
No, and that's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to make everything as transparent as possible. And showing the two different percentages, the 5 point something percent versus the 4 point, really all that's trying to do is show that we have a new line item within our budget, just like we try to break out any other new initiatives that we have within the budget. We highlight those and break them out. Maybe not as to in that same regard as to how they hit the bottom line, but it's just trying to show from budget to budget, the comparisons that this is what it would be. It's not trying to, in the graph that we have there.
But that's the point I guess I'm making is that if this is a one-time decrease or an extraordinary decrease, let's say. And I don't know if it is or not.
It is. It's a good amount.
But
it's a large sum.
It means that potentially in the next year that would be back at a level similar to what it was last year.
It could be.
And we'll be explaining a much higher increase next year.
I think, as Chuck said, that we're trying to have a transparency and an honesty in presentation of what's the data that we're working
but
with
we're
now.
We're making a very specific point of taking out the GASB.
Because
so
that's
we're not saying anything about adding back the tuition. So to me, we're not doing the same.
Well, here's a thought in terms of where we are in our process. We're meeting tonight. We're also going to have a special meeting on January 7th to finally approve the budget. And at some point in January, we're going to be sitting down with the town, having that presentation about GASB, after which I have the feeling that we'll be able to say for sure what the dollar amount commitment is that we want to be making to GASB. And then perhaps at that point, that number goes back into that percentage, and we just use it as a talking point, and we lose that smaller percentage number. Because I do see what David's saying, and if we're making the exception this year, are we going to be trying to do that the following year?
Yeah. Well, I don't think that it's, again, it's The other reason it got broken out is it's not a mandatory funding requirement.
No, but once the town makes it, if we sit down with the town and come to a conclusion, I would say that we're going to be making a commitment as a board.
Right.
It'll be up to a vote of the board, of course. But in terms of making that initial commitment, that's where you put your first foot down, and then in following years, you're going to be compared to what you did in that first year.
Right.
I think it's useful to isolate that figure, because we ought not to enter into a process where inadvertently we are held hostage to a decision that really has nothing to do with the providing of a general and special education for the students in the school. It's an entirely new financial initiative. With regard to the uncertainty of what happens in any 1 year to either fixed, apparently fixed, or variable cost, we need to look only at the five-year budgets that we've been projecting and see that in each case, the next year looks significantly different from what we thought it might be when we projected the five-year period. And some of that is inadvertent, like the disappearance of a tuition, a reduction of a tuition. But some of it is a positive intervention on behalf of the administration to change the faculty profile. The headcount is projected not to change, but we saw last year, we learned 2 years ago not to build into the budget a reality that we couldn't control, and we built in the expectation that we would see the disappearance of two or three, I think it was three faculty positions. That didn't happen. Last year we went ahead with a line item that showed no reduction in faculty, and then offered in a timely fashion a retirement incentive. That there was no retirement incentive built into the projection for next year, but I would assume it would be something that the administration is looking carefully at, and at the appropriate time we would get a recommendation as to what might be attractive both to the board and to the senior faculty members to reduce that. So I think we ought not to be concerned that line items have a lot of variability. It's the unhappy aspect of all this. It's sort of fun to talk in terms of fixed costs, but nothing's very fixed.
So let's talk a little bit about that. So the retirement incentive, right now we're not projecting any retirements, and we'll be discussing that at a later date.
We're not projecting any retirements in the budget. I think that would be a mistake to do that. And
certainly found the 1 year we did it, did not work out.
Well, we constantly, as Carl mentioned, what we're doing is constantly looking over, we're developing our staffing profile, because in simple terms, we don't want to have a situation whether it's 2 years from now, 5 years from now, where all of a sudden 20 people are leaving the school. So we're looking at that, and if there's good data that shows that we should move forward with something that's agreeable with the WEA as far as some kind of incentive, then we'll always consider that. But always looking at the interest of the children and the system.
And that's also just the graying of our workforce as well. That was sort of happening with the aging of the baby boomers. So managing that process, I think, is really crucial. And that's what Guy is talking about when we say that we want to not have sudden departures. If we can stagger them at all, that is to our advantage. In terms of smoothing over from year to year to year in our request.
Right.
But I do think that the Gatsby number is, it's a significant difference this year, and I think it will, you know, this is where the conversation with the Board of Finance and Board of Selectmen is going to be crucial. Because if they're handling it on their side too, taxpayers in general are going to see it across the board. And it does come back to the town as a whole in terms of their ability to borrow and the cost for borrowing. So this is what it's prudent to do.
I just wanted to know the 15% increase in medical insurance, you know, you're projecting for next year. Is the town using the same percentage number?
Not at this point. I think they're waiting. They're able to wait a little bit because they don't have to do their budget in the same time frame. So they'll probably be waiting to get some more months of claims data in before they make that final determination.
We did something similar last year where we discussed with them that we're, that's a preliminary number for us, we're putting the 15% in. How did it work out this year? Do you know off the top of your head?
Yeah, it worked out well. Actually, the increase came in a little bit higher than what we had budgeted for, but with some changing in our staffing elections as to which plan they wanted to be on and so forth, we're actually seeing some savings in that line item that we're using to offset some of our special education overruns.
And you're using a similar number this year, you're coming up with a number in a similar fashion this year?
Yes, it's, taking a look at what our claims data is to date, and then looking at health costs themselves as to what they're tracking.
Okay. I had the other thing I wanted to sort of highlight was the utilities, the heating oil, electricity. We had gone into the electricity agreement, mm-hmm. and we talked a little bit at the Finance Committee, but did you want to mention also how that's working out for this year?
As far as which part, the agreement that we entered into?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's working out well. I think we don't have huge savings, but we're definitely seeing savings, and I think by entering into the multi-year contract, at least at this point in time, I don't see electricity costs coming down, so I think by entering into the multi-year contract, I think that was a good thing.
I don't know if Chuck can answer this, but you have on the personnel summary, know the new staff, people personnel services, the only one listed that doesn't actually reference a person, but you still have 2.5. What does that mean?
Personnel, is that you're talking about the two psychologists
yeah.
and the,
mm-hmm.
and
oh,
the
okay.
half social worker?
That's what
social
it is,
worker.
Two psychologists
yeah.
and social worker,
right.
Okay.
So I guess the idea of scheduling with the town to talk about Gatsby, is that something, do we know anything more about when the town is planning to?
The only thing I know is that we're shooting for sometime in January, but I think the various boards have to be contacted to determine what works best for them. But.
And then remind us, when we're doing our budget presentation, very end of January, February 1st?
I don't think we have a firm date. We usually shoot for the beginning of February. We're usually the last one, I believe. So I would like to see the beginning of February if possible.
Great.
Do we need a motion to applaud their diligence and the outcome of this and accept it in its present form, recognizing there are some changes likely to arise before the final edition?
I would second that motion, Carl. Is that your motion?
Move it.
Second. All those in favor of praising the presentation thus far, with the understanding that we'll have more detail at the January meeting?
Sure.
Yep.
Dr. Stoll, I thought that the enrollment projection that you have done was especially thoughtful and comprehensive and shows the sort of forward thinking that you and your administration are doing so that we can sort of deliver the initiatives in the education appropriately with an eye to moving to what the realities are in the future.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Any other comments? All those in favor? We're going to go into our updates. We have a PTO update.
First, I'm going to present this holiday tray to the board with hopes that you'll take a break at some point and enjoy it this evening, because after this evening I'm sure it will disappear. Just to let you know that the parent volunteers will be very busy tomorrow putting together a total of 16 of these baskets for our faculty, staff, and administration to show our appreciation through the holiday season. We've just completed a very, very successful book fair. We were able to give each teacher in the school a $10 gift certificate, which they used to buy books for their classrooms. And we gave $85 to the library as a small gift before we found out what our total profit was. We profited between $4,000 and $5,000, which we'll turn around and obviously give back to the school. But we've just found out that by running two book fairs a year for the last couple of years, we've earned a credit with Scholastic Books of over $3,000, which we can now give to our classrooms and our library to purchase books and other items from the Scholastic catalog, which is just phenomenal. It's just a bonus. Tomorrow, parent volunteers will also, in addition to these lovely trays, be wrapping toys. Our annual toy drive is complete, and tomorrow we'll be wrapping toys for our families in need, which is really something. And just to follow up with what Dr. Stella said about the owl, have a look at it. This is truly an interesting story of perseverance. If anyone has read the two-page article, there was a little blurb about it. And just to say that the original artist backed out and took the funds. So they were able to find another artist who donated some supplies. They got donations of stone and parent volunteers. Really, it was an amazing test of their fortitude. So go and have a look at it. Thank you very much.
I don't know if there's enough light out there tonight.
No, maybe not.
Next time
too much
we're
ice.
Daylight.
Too much ice.
The board is here daylight. Okay, our next item is board goals, and I just want to... Policy committee, I believe, was snowed out.
Yes.
What's happening in December to us? Ad hoc communications committee. We reviewed sample communications from other districts. I think you all know that Dr. Stella's intention is that there be a written communication that goes out. Target is the end of January. That will be sort of a state of the schools. And the communications committee will meet again in January to review a draft of that communication. We also received a status on the new and revised district website, which is in progress. The team is taking the time to do it right. This includes instructions so that content moving forward will be updated in a timely fashion, because that updated content will be appropriately distributed to many folks around the school. We began the discussion in a very small way of setting appropriate guidelines for what kinds of things might be on the website over time, with the recognition that policies, board policies, are already in place supporting web content that spell out how administrative approval of content takes place. And the discussion included the recognition that the power of the web is to encourage creativity and initiative, and derives from that creativity and initiative, and so any such guidelines would be balanced with not becoming a stumbling block. We'll meet again in January.
I have a question.
Sure.
With the Honeywell system, was that something that needs to be, when it's a snow day, is that initiated?
No, it's not. That's a good question. With the Honeywell system, we have a list that there's so many names for each child.
Right.
If we initiate it, I think we're going to have parents plus grandparents and friends and everything, everybody being notified and then getting calls. So my understanding was it wasn't the initial intent of the instant alert to be used in that way. What we are doing is we're going by land, sea, and water. Not only radio and television, but you have even underneath on the television, and you have websites to go to and things like that. So that's why we haven't used instant alert. In the future, we could always look into things and and change and so on, but...
Because that was one of the things that it had as an option with it, is to have it as green or been done as an emergency thing, so I was just wondering if that was something...
Well, you know what, we'll go back and revisit the incident alert, because again, we lost our technology person who was dealing with it, so we're playing a little catch-up. At this point, I would not use it because of the long list of names for each child, and I think it might cause more of a problem than anything. But it's something we could certainly revisit, and if it makes sense, we'll do it.
I think there was interest in potentially using it in the event of an early dismissal, not
yeah.
in a delay.
Yeah, that I would be more inclined to do. Because
I know that I've had some people that have actually brought kids to the school on the snow day and turned around and came back, so that's what I'm just...
They should be taking the bus.
You know, we'll look into everything, but
okay,
but there are all kinds of options, too, of getting on certain websites and going to the, and I'm just encouraging the community. We're trying our best. There are over 10 different sources that we're hitting. I don't get up 10:30 in the morning for nothing. So we're trying our best to communicate, and if there's a way of doing it better, we'll try to do it better.
And I would also urge people to go ahead and give you input if they have experiences
sure.
like that. We don't want to minimize if someone's trying to drop off and they didn't realize. We want to make sure that we do
yeah.
that. So any input that the community has for us while we work on this. To
absolutely. Any kind of input is welcome.
I don't know if this is anything that we can do, but I've had experiences with I get called at 6 o'clock whenever there's a delay. Or schools closed due to weather, I'm just on some type of phone system for a different school. But I mean, it's a recording, but it's really great. You get it at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, they call those systems reverse 911. They can be used for emergency
mm-hmm.
or simple phone trees like that.
It's been great.
Yeah, it's something that PTOs sometimes sponsor as well. So. As we continue, I think, with the communications committee, as that website comes up to date, there's going to be a notification idea going on there as well. So, communications committee can do that.
We'll put it on the agenda. Right?
Yes. Okay, CABE liaison report. I want to open it up to our two new board members who attended a CABE new board member orientation. And if you want to tell us how that went.
Sure. I thought it was terrific. We had a day of, it was from noon until about 8:15 at night, working in an intimate setting with many other new board members, as well as a couple of superintendents and other administrators there, and learning a lot about our role as a board, understanding. By the way, let me start by saying that I was very impressed with the operation of this board after hearing some of the stories that they shared through their experiences. I think we all have a mutual respect for one another and for Dr. Stella and the administration and the teachers, and I think that goes a long way toward doing what we all have to do. So it made us, I think, speaking of Tom, we felt good about being a part of that. But there were many lessons learned that they shared with us, mistakes made by prior boards. For example, there were stories about freedom of information requests by board members against the superintendents. You know, bad things. Like, well, what's going on out there? So, Tom, I'll turn it over to you.
Yeah, I'll reiterate that. I think it was a very useful session. I think it made me quite happy that I was on this board and not on other boards or in other districts. That I thought that
give us time.
With the exception of. No, but I mean, I think it was a very useful thing. I think that I also would applaud Marsha's efforts to get us some of the information. You know, as we were been on the board for many months, more than many of the new members who had just gotten elected, I thought that the material that we were given, you know, much of which came from CABE initially, really did prepare us. And in some ways, there was some reiteration of the material that we had gotten earlier. But I still think it was incredibly valuable to meet and talk with board members. Some are new and you hear some horror stories about what's going on, but others, there were some experienced board members there as well, and to get some of their feedback, and it does make us appreciate it. I think that this is a community that works well. I think that's great. So,
good.
It's good to have that opportunity.
Well, thank you. That was an excellent CABE liaison report. ACES liaison report.
It's no Thursday, and they can't
open. Another December outcome. Okay, next on our agenda is new business. Can I entertain a motion?
I move that we ratify the contract between the Woodbridge Board of Education and the Woodbridge Association of Schools Administrators as presented effective July 1st, 2008 through June 30th, 2009.
Very good. A second? Any discussion? All those in favor? Anyone opposed or abstaining? Unanimous vote. I just wanted to say a few words about this contract. It is a one-year agreement with our three-member administrator union. It provides for a 3.9% increase in wages. It increases the contribution paid by employees to the health care insurance from 12% to 14%. I want to say that we feel this is a good agreement. While being respectful to taxpayers and fiscally responsible, it allows us to demonstrate a commitment to the continuity of leadership in our administrators. Meeting time. Do we have a motion or a discussion?
Strategically, how to do this. Well, I'll move that we shift our regular Board of Ed meeting to commence henceforth at 6:30 p.m. This is with the intent of having our meetings. Should I explain? That's the motion.
That's the motion. We need a second. Now discussion.
Okay, so you know, I think there's an interest in everybody here to have our meetings conclude at a reasonable hour, and I think it's not just for board members, but for the administration who comes out, you know, at least once a month, if not more often, and staff to. Allow everybody, PTO, everybody to be able to get back, get to bed, get ready for the next day, and that was the intent here.
Do we have any other discussion of that? Now, we're talking about the times only, the meeting dates themselves. Have we already, we're going to be seeing that, Jim?
Meeting dates in October.
Okay. I have questions.
Sure.
By changing it to 6:30, that means if we have an executive session, it's 5:30, correct?
Not necessarily. We can put executive session anywhere in the agenda. We could put it at the end, we could put it in the middle.
Okay.
We could put it at the beginning if it'll fit.
Well, then I guess what I want to put in is if you want to start the meetings at 6:30, then I would request that executive session is always at the end.
Unless we can do it in enough. 5:30 is probably pushing it for most people.
Can't pick up your kids and get here. It's not possible. 6 o'clock executive sessions are really tough.
And I think we need to be mindful that we need quorum to start any meeting. So if we're going to run into trouble with that, we don't want to do that. Yes?
Okay. My question is, if it starts at 6:30, is this something going to be budgetary that we have to include dinner into this, or are we all going to eat before 6:30?
Well, I think David's intention is we're going to get out and we can just have our dinner at 8:30. I wouldn't anticipate a budget input for this.
Okay, that's our next question, because if it is you know.
Good to know.
And you're
going to have to have more sex
and not starting in July.
No, starting this immediately.
The training.
Well, I like the idea of starting earlier. I applaud that. I'm a little concerned with sort of making a statement that we're going to do the executive sessions at the end, only because I think many times the executive sessions are containing material that we need to be fully awake, you know, and sometimes the meetings go long.
Or they deal with issues that we may have to address
in the meeting itself. So we have to be careful to try to plan that out so we don't wait till the end of a long meeting and then go into executive session and then have to come back. back out.
Well, let me ask this, and maybe Marcia, you can help us with this. If we post the meeting, just the regular meetings as beginning at 6:30, and we come to a meeting where we feel we're going to need an hour-long executive session that we do feel needs to be at the beginning of the meeting, if we are simply in time for the posting, saying our meeting is beginning at whatever time it's beginning, and the public session won't begin until 7 o'clock, we're able to do that. I think as long as we're actually having a meeting, the fact that we're in executive session, I know that we could call a meeting to order, have a portion of the public meeting, and then go into executive session. I've certainly seen that happen with boards. So the fact that you're saying the meeting is beginning does not mean that the public has a right to be in the room when you're, whatever that time is. I think that if we're posting the agenda, it's very courteous to the public to say, we expect we're not going to be in public session until 7 o'clock. I think we have the latitude to do that.
You would have latitude as long as you post clearly as to start time for public session.
Right.
And that's why on your meeting notices you always have executive session commencing at X time and public session beginning at Y.
Good. So if we continue that, we're intending to start the meeting earlier and not start any earlier than 6 o'clock. So that's really what we're talking about.
Oh, I'm confused because today we had a meeting that started at 5:30. And, we had a non-meeting, excuse me. But we had people here that didn't require a quorum at 5:30, and but it wasn't a meeting.
We're not talking about it now.
Well, no, but we are talking about getting together as a group, and I think we all have to do what we need to do to get here. The intent here is to start earlier and end earlier. And if there's conditions that will always push it back, then we haven't really achieved what our goal is. What I was hesitating originally was I was going to move that we start these things at 6, not at 6:30. I felt that was a compromise to begin with.
I can remember a time when we started at 7:30. The board of ed started at 7:30. And, we've gone to 7, and I think that if 6:30, we're going to do a vote in a moment, if 6:30 is agreeable to us, we can begin at 6:30. And I think we are making good strides in keeping the meeting compact and yet covering what we need to cover. It's a balance. Yes.
For the amount of times we have executive sessions, to keep it at 6:30, I will agree with you. I like the idea of 6:30. And it's not that many times that we actually need an executive session to be at that point. And if it's well posted beforehand, I don't think it's a problem for the minimal amount of times we have. And most of the other times, if we need to do something, it's not during this Monday night meeting anyway. So if it's a special meeting, it's not going to occur at this particular time anyways. So I think it's fine.
Are we ready to vote on the motion?
Just one point of clarification, only because I want to be sure when we communicate this to the town clerk, you are going to amend your regular meetings from 7 o'clock to 6:30 p.m. And you will adjust the executive sessions accordingly dependent on the issue.
Yes, that's what we would tell the town clerk. We need to file with them by January when our regular meeting dates and times.
Oh no, you had to file by October, which we did.
Oh, the dates.
Yes.
We have until January though to tell them about the dates.
Correct.
If we send them now, it's not too late. Okay. Any other discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Anyone abstaining? Okay, motion passes. Okay, finance. Carl.
I've often said that your position on the agenda is sometimes a happenstance. Thank God I have a very short report after spending 10 minutes talking only about how valuable time is. And thank God also that the financial report shows considerable variability in the results, having earlier said that almost nothing at all in the budget is fixed. Thank God that the data for this month at least reflect that uncomfortable reality. As has been reported, the Board of Ed Finance Committee did meet on Monday, December 10th. And I think that the only thing that's worth commenting that hasn't been mentioned already is that at one point in the meeting, I inquired as to whether there was any stomach for a line-by-line review of the budgetary requests, and the answer to that was a resounding no. So I think what we accomplished was, in fact, an overview of the issues, and the narrative report solved our need to know that what the numbers meant, what the content was, what the program was all about. So we did not get down into what I would describe as a micromanagerial step to figure out whether the $100 on page 9, column 4 was really an appropriate number. We did review the various financial data for the fiscal year ending, year-to-date ending November 30th. Chuck indicated that there were no issues that he was particularly concerned about, and I would ask again to reiterate if that conviction is still the same. And point out to you, as I've said before, that at the end of November, we're projecting, we're indicating a favorable variance of $213,000, and would urge you not to go out and spend that, because in fact, the bulk of that is timing issues. And in fact, if we adjust for all the things that are in play that aren't occurring exactly when we thought they would occur, we probably have a $9,000 or $10,000 unfavorable variance at the end of November. Nothing to be terribly concerned about at this point, but don't be deceived by the positive numbers. Chuck also indicated that he had done some projections based on ongoing developments, the arrival of the expected insights into the unexpected events in special education, and that produces probably a break-even outcome for the year, end of the fiscal year, but once again, we have no idea as to what unforeseen issues will arise, both in special ed and in general ed. We reviewed the combining balance sheets as of November 30th and the combining statement of revenues and expenditures for November 30th. Once again, no items that were particularly noteworthy. We did discuss the the circumstances in the cafeteria, and we tossed around the idea of doing something formal on reviewing options there that might be done later. So I would offer the following motion: that we approve the 2007-2008 Board of Ed monthly summary financial report through November 30th, 2007, F1, as submitted by the business manager.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Move that we approve the 2007-2008 Board of Ed monthly detail financial report ending November 30th, F2 through F5, as submitted by the business manager.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed or abstaining? Motion passes.
And move that we approve the 2007-2008 combined financial statements through November 30th, 2007. Pages F6, F7, as submitted by the business manager.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Anyone opposed or abstaining? Motion passes. Anything further on finance? Okay. Excellent job with the finance. We are at old business. Old business. Scott, would you like to talk?
Well, I wanted to talk about some old. I have my administrators here, and Nancy White, and some of the teachers. Whole business for my trip to China. It seemed like a short time ago. And since that time, I've had a chance to report back to to staff and to children from grades 1 to 6. I believe this Friday I'm doing with kindergarten. Had a chance to speak to the Board of Selectmen. It's been a wonderful response from the community. About people, children, parents telling me about their experiences in China and so on. But it's not meant to end with my trip, and I just wanted to share some good news with you. Because of our sister school relationship, I opened this up to staff. Staff members were encouraged to apply for the Confucius Scholarship, which meant is tied into the sisterhood project, sister school project. And one of our staff members, Nancy White, applied and was accepted in the Confucius project and will be traveling to China during the spring recess to our sister school to further develop the relationships and to establish some very, very concrete ways of communicating. There are lots of ideas that we're throwing around, but I think this is really a feather in the cap of Beecher Road School. And the funding will be through grant funding. And the time will be substantially during that recess time. So again, you have an indicator of a teacher giving up her vacation time in the service of children. There'll be a few days before, but we'll make sure that the children will profit from that, because I'm sure there'll be some direct communication with Nancy from her site. And with the learnings that I gained from there, I think we're going to be able to have a good follow-up. So I want to thank Nancy for stepping forward. And also, the other fact is that Dr. Ballinger from the Bethany Middle School applied also and was accepted. So our elementary school and our middle school will be able to make some very, very wonderful links. This also ties into the social studies curriculum development that was mentioned by Mrs. Torrey, because again, we want our children not only to learn about cultures, but interact with cultures. It ties in with our technology initiative, because we're working on virtual communication with Hong Kong. Singapore is next. We're looking at some other places in the world, and this will be another type of tie-in. So I just wanted to acknowledge Nancy and her professionalism and the way she always steps forward, ready to go that extra mile.
Receive and file, and public comment. Motion for adjournment.
I just have one thing.
Yes.
Just to add to the CAVE report that they had presented, I brought up in the past, the CAVE has this policy software that we might want to look into, and they presented it there. And I would urge us all to go to look at the Cheshire School website that has the working policy software up and running, and I do think we really should seriously consider looking into it. I'm not sure exactly what cost, but it's a quite impressive system that allows you to pretty much type in any search word you want and find every policy that has that word in it, and it also has links to some of the statutes that apply to the policy. And I just think it's important for us to take a look at that, and maybe we can pursue that avenue.
That would be a great idea. Maybe the policy committee at its next meeting could take a look, which is there. Okay, motion for adjournment. Do we have that?
So moved.
Second? Hi, all those in favor.